Welcome to Brains Matter, the podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. Hi everyone, and welcome to another episode of Brains Matter. On today's episode, I have an interview with Professor Mike Sandiford, who's a senior research fellow from the School of Earth Sciences from the University of Melbourne, and he talks to me about geothermal energy. But first off, we have a brain teaser. What weather phenomenon is measured by the Beaufort scale? The answer to that later in the show. There's been a lot of discussion lately about different energy sources. We've got geothermal energy, solar energy, wind energy, and so on, especially given the press that climate change has had. One of the most interesting types of energy sources that has been discussed is geothermal energy, and to talk to me about that is Professor Mike Sandiford from the School of Earth Sciences from Melbourne University. So welcome to the show, Mike.
Thanks, Professor.
So a little bit about geothermal power. There's people think about geothermal power in two senses, the ones who know a bit about it anyway. You have deep geothermal power and shallow geothermal power. So just to start off with, can you tell the listeners what geothermal power is?
Well, geothermal power is simply energy we can get by exploiting the heat that naturally occurs at depth within the Earth. And rather than distinguish between shallow and deep, we'd probably better distinguish between conventional geothermal power, the sort of geothermal power that New Zealanders use or is used in Iceland, where there is active volcanism and a lot of steam vented to the earth through the processes of heat transfer from the magmas that are at depth rising through the crust, heating groundwaters in the shallow crust, causing those groundwaters to rise and vent to the surface of the earth. That's conventional geothermal power. It works very well. It is used to supply Iceland with energy. Significant energy, electricity is generated in New Zealand through that. But of course, it's no good for places like Australia, which simply don't have volcanoes. And we're trying to explore for a new type of geothermal energy, just using the natural heat that exists in the ground by injecting water to deep levels in the crust, 4 or 5 kilometres, where the heat is sufficient to heat those waters, convert them to steam, return them to the surface, use them for energy before pumping them back into the earth again.
So how efficient is that compared to conventional geothermal power?
What we know is that there are areas of the earth's crust which are sufficiently hot at these depths, which are still shallow by the earth's crust standards, 4 or 5 kilometres, to theoretically make it work.
Okay.
The problem is at this stage no one's made it work. In Australia, we've only just started the exploration, and the first explorers at the stage where they're beginning the pumping tests to pump fluids into the crust to see how the fluids will move through the crust, see if they can recover them with sufficient energy to not only pump the fluids back in, but take energy out to make electricity.
Mm-hmm. So in terms of the heat comes from just the natural heat from the earth as you go further
That's
deep.
Right.
The further you go into the earth, how much does the temperature increase?
Okay, if we were to drill a hole down through Melbourne, we would expect the temperatures to rise about 25 to 30 degrees per kilometre.
Mm-hmm.
So the top surface of the very soil on which Melbourne is built has an average temperature of about 15 to 20 degrees. Obviously it gets hotter in the summer, colder in winter, hotter in the day, colder at night, but averaging about 15 to 20 degrees. So 30 degrees per kilometre, 5 kilometres, we're 170 degrees or thereabouts. The heat inside the Earth comes from two sources. One is residual heat still trying to escape from the Earth from when it was first created 4.5 billion years ago out of the solar nebula. The other is from the natural radioactive decay, principally of uranium, also potassium and thorium. The uranium, which sits in the crust, undergoes fission, producing heat as it does, and that keeps the crust warm. Typically, as I say, for the continents, the crust temperature rises between 25 and 30 degrees per kilometre.
So is this the sort of energy source that would actually never run out? So one of the issues that conventional fossil fuels have is that at some point it's not feasible to economically obtain much of it anymore, or at a point where it will run out. Is this the sort of thing that, if we do it properly, could continue to provide us energy for the foreseeable and ongoing future?
The heat in the earth that we can access through this is virtually limitless. And it is true to say that the heat will regenerate itself, but on long time scales. Uranium, thorium, the isotopes, the radioactive isotopes that we use, have half-lives approaching the age of the planet. So they will be around much, much longer than we will be. And they will regenerate the heat. Exactly how we exploit the heat within a particular geothermal reservoir will depend very much on the longevity of that reservoir. Mm-hmm. We have some things to do with those reservoirs to make them available to release their heat. For example, we have to generate fractures inside the rock mass at 4 or 5 kilometres depth, along which the fluids will flow between an injection well and a set of recovery wells which surround the injection well. If we break the rock open at those depths by pumping the fluid at pressures higher than the natural pressures of the rocks, they may open one fracture between the injection well and the recovery well, and that will be disastrous. Mm. Because what they will cause to do is all the water to flow along one fracture, rapidly exploiting the heat from the small region around that one fracture, depleting that resource very quickly. Mm. What we want to do is develop a network of fractures, but not a network of fractures which go in every direction, a network of fractures which go out from the injection well and somehow come back to the recovery well, so that the fluid can go out and then return. We don't want too much loss of fluid. We don't want the fluid to go along one fracture. So it's quite a complicated procedure. This type of geothermal energy approach has been used in tried in other parts of the world, but they've had trouble in making the fractures work. Partly they've had trouble in making the fractures work because the stress regime, the natural stress regime in the crust, has been favourable to developing vertical fractures, which cause the fluids to move up through the crust away from the recovery well, so they don't get good connection. Here, we believe that the natural stress regime in the crust will be one which is amenable to opening horizontal fractures. That'll help keep the water in the reservoir, the thermal reservoir we want, and hopefully also allow us to develop appropriate fracture networks to get good dispersal of water, but not too much dispersal of water, so mm-hmm. it can come back to the recovery wells. But this is all theoretical at this stage. We haven't got to that stage of getting the reservoirs to perform.
And in putting these fractures in, is that a difficult process in itself?
What we have to do is overpressure the fluids as we pump them into the rocks at the very deep levels, 4 or 5 kilometres down, along drill holes that we've created to those depths, and fracture the rock in the depth of the reservoir. The sort of technology that we're using is used reasonably commonly in petroleum and gas mm-hmm. extraction. So we have some information about how to engineer these resources. But many of our geothermal resources will be in different sorts of rocks. Natural gas, oil reservoirs are always in sedimentary rocks because that's where the organic matter comes from, the decayed organic matter which allows the hydrocarbon accumulation, the oil sure. and the gas. Mm-hmm. Granites are rich in uranium and therefore generate the heat which makes the reservoirs for this type of geothermal. They have very different fracture characteristics than sedimentary rocks, so we don't have much experience at naturally fracturing granites at depth. This type of operation is a bit like doing open heart surgery from the next block away. We're operating 5 kilometres away from where we're trying to perform this procedure deep inside the earth, and we have to learn how to control it. We will learn how to control it with experience, but there are going to be some issues along the way.
Is there a distinct advantage in specifically selecting your site, so choosing granite-type rocks and compared to sedimentary rocks and so on?
Well, we tend to choose granite rocks, or so far the industry here in Australia has been exploring for granite rocks because they contain the uranium, which makes the extra heat. Of course, the way in which heat is trapped in the earth is not only dependent on how it's generated, but it's dependent on how good the rocks are as conductors of heat. Turns out granites are quite good conductors, so our ideal reservoir is a reservoir which has granites buried under rather more insulating sorts of rocks like shales or sedimentary rocks which have a lot of organic material in them, a lot of carbon in them. They're the sorts of situations which occur in the Cooper Basin in northern South Australia, where the first and most successful explorers have tried to identify geothermal reservoirs. And they have done that. They're drilling at something like 4 kilometres depth at the moment, and they're over 200 degrees temperature. So very high geothermal gradients.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, we've known geothermal gradients in that part of the world because prior to the exploration for geothermal energy, there was a lot of natural gas production, and they had to drill quite deeply to that, so we already recorded temperatures.
Mm-hmm.
So in that part of the world, they already had a head start on their exploration for geothermal energy. The other parts, we haven't had nearly so much drilling, so we are really trying now to identify what the thermal structure, what the good reservoirs are.
If you've chosen a site and use the heat that's generated from that particular site, is there a point where the heat will diminish, where it becomes inefficient, and then can you come back at a later point in time once it's replenished its heat?
Theoretically, you could, but if you're diminishing the heat on the timescale at which you can no longer get power, it becomes a very inefficient process for generating power. So I doubt whether we'd be able to generate the funds to do such a thing.
So what kind of timescales are we talking about? So if we put in a site, how long would it generate power for?
Again, it depends very much on how we manage that reservoir characteristic. If we can get the fluids to go out from the rock mass in a dispersed way, but still eventually come back from the injection well to the recovery well, i.e. get the fluids to access a large volume of rock, we've got many decades worth of potential energy resource.
Okay.
Of course, if we simply open one fracture from one injection well to the other, it'll be exhausted in a very short time, and no money will be gained by trying to exploit the energy reserve.
How far away do these sites have to be from a city? Could they be located in an urban location, or is there some sort of risk associated with having it near a population?
Obviously, the most successful of these will be ones where we can generate the electricity close to existing power grids.
Mm-hmm.
The problem at the moment for many of the most prospective sites is that they're
far away,
far from power grids, so there's an enormous capital investment required simply to get the energy that may be produced to places where it may be used, which jeopardises the likely successful outcome of those exploration programmes. It doesn't mean that they're impossible, but it certainly makes them more difficult than otherwise. So, in many ways, ideally, for the electricity production, getting them on the power grid is useful. There are some issues to do with exploring under cities, and it was highlighted almost 2 years ago now by some European exploration under the city of Basel in Switzerland, where when they went to what they call stimulate the reservoir, that is injecting overpressured fluid to generate fractures, they generated a weak earthquake, a magnitude 3 earthquake. This is class of earthquakes which we call induced earthquakes. We always get them when we almost always get them when we fill big dams. So when we begin to stimulate reservoirs, and we might have good reservoirs in the Latrobe Valley, for example, where active exploration is, we will inevitably generate some earthquakes. Our challenge, I guess, is to learn how to make sure that those earthquakes are small and not hazardous, and that people are alert to the fact that this is a natural process,
mm-hmm,
and not a worrying process.
The listener of the episode for today is Turgis from Adelaide in South Australia. Thanks for signing the Frapper map on the website, Turgis. Presumably the carbon emissions from an energy source like this would be minimal compared to, you know, the traditional coal-fired power stations and so on. Is it zero, or is there some amount that comes out with a power station associated with geothermal energy, if we discount the manufacturing process for parts that go into a power
station? That's right. As you've just alluded, any build-up towards an energy infrastructure now uses, in part, coal-fired or gas-powered or diesel-powered electric generation. So there's obviously a greenhouse gas footprint. But up and running, these things have no reason why they should be generating any CO2, in the sense that they generate the power which is used to drive the fluid pressure and the operation of the plants. And if they can't return net power, then they're clearly not going to succeed. They won't attract any investment. So once up and running, there's no need to see them as generating any CO2. They do have demands on water resources, of course, which is another issue. We can't afford to lose very much water. Mm-hmm. We're using water to pump into the ground, recovering that water. We need to be able to recover a high proportion of the water.
Approximately what proportion of the water is recoverable and reusable? Presumably some of it will be lost during the process, but what is the proportion of water that we hope to recover?
In a sense, you can understand that the water recovery has to be high, both to return the energy, but also for the sustainability of the water supply, especially if we're working in particularly arid parts of the continent, but just about anywhere in South Australia where water pressure is huge.
Given that it's been successful in Iceland and New Zealand, and if you could just speak to that a little bit more about what is the proportion of energy that those two locations get from geothermal compared to the traditional power sources?
As I understand that the proportion of the geothermal energy from Iceland, and it's the traditional source of geothermal, where they're using steam generated from the release of heat from cooling magmas at depth, at shallow depths in the crust, is very large. I think almost all their electricity runs from a combination of that and hydro, as I understand. I may be wrong. New Zealand is smaller. The geothermal energy plants around Rotorua, for example, supply a significant but minor component of the energy needs of New Zealand. In Australia, it's too early to say what contribution will make, if any. We're still at the stage where we're trying to explore the concept. It should be emphasised that electricity production is just one of the potential uses of geothermal. Geothermal can be used for a whole lot of potential other sources, lower grade. If the temperatures in the waters return to the surface less than about 150 degrees, we'll be looking to use them not for electricity production, but for lower grade direct use applications like heating. We could potentially use them, for example, in the Latrobe Valley to help dry the coal or to make the CO2 capture technologies more efficient, where we need significant amounts of energy added to the system to make that work.
Okay, so there's multiple avenues of validity for geothermal.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. It's a source of energy. That energy obviously has attractions in electricity production, unlike wind and solar, because it's able, if it works, to have baseload capacity. That is, it can be run night and day, whether it's windy or not, throughout the seasons. The baseload capacity provides an attraction. The extraordinary amount of energy which is down in there in the crust provides another attraction.
Mm-hmm.
Our ability to get that energy out and utilize that energy is
the tricky part.
Next hurdle we have to face.
So in terms of the pipes being put into the ground, are they just straight holes effectively, or do we need to put some sort of metal pipe or carbon pipes or something around it?
We will be injecting into grounds specific targets, so in order to stop fluid escaping on the way to the target depth, we'll need to case the holes.
Mm-hmm.
So there'll be holes which are cased to the depths that we want to penetrate the rock, similarly with the recovery. Another issue to do with geothermal in general, an issue that we will have to learn about, is as we inject fluids into hot rock masses, those fluids will begin to react with the rock, dissolving some of the minerals, some places precipitating them in other places, precipitating them in the wells as the fluid rises up and decompresses. It's an issue to manage because, of course, eventually you can generate scaly deposits inside the drilling apparatus.
So that was going to lead on to my next question, which was, are there any, from a geological perspective, are there any side effects from obtaining this heat from the earth? Because it's not something natural, it's something that we as humans are going to introduce into that particular area.
Earthquakes generate from overpressuring the fluid and physically fracturing the rock. Any earthquake is actually a fracture process going on, or a slip on a fracture plane inside the earth. So those earthquakes will be generated during the overpressuring, by generating the fracture through which the fluids will go. Challenge then is, of course, to keep them open by maintaining high pressures, by not having too many chemical reactions or precipitates form inside the fractures as the ongoing fluids. The fluids are pumped through in an ongoing sense. In terms of the total heat recovery from the amount of heat that we can mine from the earth will be trivial compared to the heat loss of the earth. So there's not any sense that this could in any way damage the earth. If we mine too much heat from one particular reservoir, that reservoir will temporarily, on the time scale of 100 years or so, 1,000 years, become unfunctional as far as an energy source, but it will build its heat again, and we have no understanding that that in any way will lead to any other consequence at the earth.
You mentioned some of the precipitates that may react with the water. Is there a risk that some of those coming to the surface might be pollutants?
They could well be in theory, but of course this will only work if we can efficiently re-inject the fluid. So what we would be trying to do is put the water that recover back down into the hole rather than disperse it across the landscape. There may be issues to do with build-ups of deposits in the near surface that need to be scraped from the system and disposed of. We would generally think of these being not particularly enriched in toxic metals. It really depends on the nature of the reservoir systems that we're dealing with and what their geochemistry is, what concentrations they have of particular soluble metals. So I guess this is still something of an unknown, but it wouldn't be considered to be one of the major hazards at this stage.
Okay. Do you foresee any other risks that we know of at the moment related to geothermal power?
Well, the big risk is that it might not work. That's the major risk. We are hopeful that we have some very good reservoirs.
But that might not work, Common. Is that more about the system itself or the technology itself not working, or particular sites not working?
Well, if we come back to our open heart surgery from a block away, it takes a lot of experimentation to get that technology to work if you're trying to do it that way. We're still at the infancy of trying to get the technology to work. We haven't even really conducted our first experiments.
Okay.
We're trying to design those experiments. We'll have a lot to learn. We're hopeful that conditions are right, that if anywhere works anywhere, we can get it to work here. We obviously need to be able to recover more energy than we expend in pumping the fluids in. We can't afford to lose too much of the fluid. We have to get that back. We can't have too much chemical damage in the system. We have to get it back. We obviously can't, especially if we're near cities, be in the process of generating large earthquakes, magnitude 5 earthquakes, otherwise we won't be allowed to do it. There are issues that are ongoing which will dictate really whether it's a successful contributor to our energy needs. If it is, it's fantastic, because of course it is a clean energy source. It's got baseload capacity. It has remarkably little impact on the surface of the earth. It has many attributes that make it a wonderful resource. To my way of thinking, it's a bit like thinking about the earth's natural nuclear reactor. The earth is the wonderful place it is because of the uranium that sits inside the crust, generating heat, forming earthquakes, causing plates to move, sitting inside the earth. The earth would not be a dynamic place without uranium. The best place to use uranium is inside the crust. It's a natural energy source, and this is what geothermal in Australia is trying to do.
And it's using it in a safe manner as well.
Well, it's using it in the manner that all the natural radioactive products from the radioactive fission are kept largely inside the earth. Of course, if we go to these locations where geothermal will be successful because there's a lot of uranium in the crust, there's a lot of radon gas leaking through the crust, and they're not necessarily places where you would want to build a house, or particularly with a big cellar, and live in a closed environment above them, because there would be natural radon hazard, as there are in many parts of the world.
So you've mentioned some of the positive attributes there before, and I could throw on top of that the fact that you mentioned in Iceland, in conventional geothermal energy, it's providing pretty much almost all of their energy requirements. It's proving useful in New Zealand. The shallow geothermal stuff that you're talking about here is in its infancy, but it also has zero carbon emissions once it's been built. As a layperson, my next question is, why hasn't there been a lot of investment in this kind of research earlier?
Well, the main reason there hasn't been a whole lot of investment in other techniques is that still the cheapest form of energy production, and our big problem, is coal. And we haven't until recently understood the damage that burning coal has been doing to our atmosphere and the repercussions of that over the 100-year timescale. Now we're alert to that. We're beginning to understand we have to treat energy sources for their full cycle, accommodating wastes, understand the implications of that. But that's only a recent realization, and we should also realize that we've built healthy, wealthy society on largely on the basis of having cheap energy supplies in this country, and that's been at the root of it. Our challenge now is to keep cheap, secure energy supplies, alternative energy supplies. They won't be as cheap as coal. They can't be as cheap as coal when you only consider the digging of the coal out of the ground. But our challenge is to develop the next cheap, relatively cheap, secure energy supply. And we think that that energy mix is going to be quite diverse. It's certainly going to involve some hydrocarbons.
Mm-hmm.
It's certainly going to involve some solar. It's certainly going to involve some wind. In parts of the world, it's going to involve hydropower, but that's not great for Australia. We're simply too flat, too dry. Hopefully here, we'll make up for that because of geothermal. We don't know whether we can. We quickly need to be able to come to the position where we say, yes, the investment in geothermal will work. It will be part of the energy mix. Or no, for these reasons, we can't make it work and put our, it's better to put our efforts elsewhere. So that's our challenge. It will be a challenge that we'll be working hard on. And the ambition, I guess, is to continue secure cheap energy for this nation and for others.
If we got a geothermal site or set of sites up, presumably the cost would be involved in that pumping of water and liquid back down and any purification that needs to occur, if it needs to. Having that in mind, presumably the cost wouldn't be that much greater than coal would once the infrastructure has been built.
Of course, what we know about coal is we simply have to put a match to it and we get the energy. It's a very simple energy source.
Yeah.
We don't yet know whether we can get energy from this geothermal technology that we're trying to apply in Australia.
Mm-hmm.
While we know there's an energy source there, we don't know whether we can recover that energy in a meaningful way, particularly to make electricity.
Okay.
So that's the challenge.
Mm-hmm.
We know the energy's there, as it is in coal, but coal we just have to throw into
an oven and heat it up.
Burn it and release the energy.
So where do you see energy mix for not just Australia but for the world being in, say, 50 years? Do you see geothermal power as becoming a lot more important? Presumably the technology by that stage will have improved so that we could generate more efficient energy, whether it's electricity or other forms of energy out of it.
Geothermal energy will work in some places where we can get the temperature gradients probably up to around 35 to 40 degrees per kilometre, as we do in several parts of Australia, but large parts of the crust have much lower geothermal gradients. While on average it might be in the crust 25 degrees per kilometre, there are parts of Western Australia, for example, where the temperature gradients 10 to 15 degrees per kilometre because there's very little uranium in the crust. It's very old crust and it's got underneath the crust particularly cold rocks, so it's not useful for this type of energy production. You'd have to drill over 15 kilometres to get to the sorts of temperatures that we're talking about, which is just not feasible. We can't drill to those depths. It depends on the part of the world that you're in, and we have lots to learn about that. But undoubtedly the energy mix will involve a mix of a range of things. If we're to really accommodate the needs of the world of providing cheap energy sources, particularly for expanding economies in the third world now, they need secure, reliable energy sources, and coal is still their best bet. So our challenge really is to make sure we can develop the technology to secure the carbon from coal. So I see carbon capture as being an important one. If we can't crack that one, I think we're in trouble because of the need to provide energy to other parts of the world. We in Australia could deal without it. We could probably cope without having to burn the coal in the medium term anyway. But the need to provide energy secure, relatively cheap to the world, seems to meet and demand, at least for the foreseeable future, coal. But hopefully in that time we'll develop capacity to make photovoltaics more efficient, more cheap. They're obviously tremendously scalable, so they have great advantage in that sense. Geothermal, wind, hydro, whole range.
Okay. Well, Professor Sandiford, thank you very much for your time today.
My pleasure.
And now for some listener feedback. Frank Connolly from Melbourne wrote in on the website in reference to the fictional scientist episode and said, I kind of like Professor Challenger from the Arthur Conan Doyle books, The Maricot Deep, The Lost World, The Day the World Screamed, a rebel and one at odds with the scientific establishment. And speaking of Conan Doyle, surely it was Holmes himself and not Watson that was the scientist of the pair. Watson was an MD, little else. A couple more, of course, Professor Carlson from Get Smart, Great Gadgets, and a Professor John Robinson from Lost in Space, not only a professor, but a hero as well. Mark West wrote in response to the episode about the greatest Olympians and said, as much as I hate to admit it, given that the Poms are giving us a considerable beating at the current Olympics, Steve Redgrave won gold at 5 consecutive Olympics in rowing. That kind of longevity is hard to beat. And Lily Kissick wrote in commenting on the episode about virtual worlds and said that she enjoyed it thoroughly, so thank you for that, Lily. And now it's time to answer today's brain teaser. The question was, what weather phenomenon is measured by the Beaufort scale? Well, the answer to that is the wind. Did you get that right? I'll leave you with a quote from Malcolm Forbes. Education's purpose is to replace an empty mind with an open one. Bye for now. Thanks for listening to the show. You can check out the BrainsMatter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link. You can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glen Goetz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.